let me set the stage. Let me make it short and brief, but very efficient. I was losing in my fantasy football game to Will Murray. I was losing to a fucking loser by, I think, 16 or 17 points. To be honest, to be totally fucking honest, I gave up. I thought there's no way I was going to come back and win. He had Emmanuel Sanders, I had Kareem Hunt, and I had the Kansas City Chiefs kicker, but I thought there's no fucking way I would do it. Lo and behold, Rapaport's Delight, a.k.a. A History of Violence, a.k.a. There Will Be Blood, came back deep, 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 late in the fucking fourth quarter. I wish I was in New York. I'm in L.A. I wish I was in New York because I know that fuck Will Murray from the Stern Show has been up all night, and that motherfucker has to wake up at the crack of fucking dawn. The crack of fucking dawn to show up at work on the Stern Show. You're going to be waking up at the crack of dawn, you fuck you. You're going to be showing up to work with your fucking head down. Because lo and behold, late in the fourth quarter, my team, Rapaport's Delight, went up with beautiful Kareem Hunt, stuffing it right through the fucking end zone. Real late in the fourth quarter, Rapaport's Delight, a.k.a. A History of Violence, has come back and won for the last 3 weeks. 3 weeks ago, I beat that dog, that filthy fucking elephant, Jason Kaplan. Last week, I beat that asshole licker. The guy said on the radio he loves to eat ass. Now, I'm not saying I do or don't love to eat ass, but you wouldn't catch me talking about it on the Howard Stern Show. And then Monday Night Football, October 1st, the first fucking night of October, late into the fourth quarter, we did it again. This is what fantasy football is all about. Yes, the agony of defeat and the motherfucking thrill of motherfucking victory. This is the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. Let's go. What's up? This is Michael Rapaport. You are now listening to the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. On today's podcast, me and G Moody are going to be discussing five hip-hop producers that are more interesting to listen to than Kanye fucking West. Candace Owens gets the Willie Hutch treatment. J.R. Smith of the Cleveland Cavaliers got a Supreme tattoo on the back of his leg, and it's the ultimate sucker shit ever. Plus, we have some fantastic, mind-boggling, sick fucks of the week. All that and more on a smash mouth, back to basics, I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast coming up next. Miles Jordan, please, let me get something funky. All right. My name is Michael Rapaport, a.k.a. the White Chocolatito, a.k.a. the Jake LaMotta of podcasts. I'm here with G. Moody. Last name rhymes with duty. His brother's name is Dean Moody. And if you can't do the math on that, his last name also rhymes with duty. This is the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast, coming live and direct from the Gloom Tomb Studios. Mr. Moody, how you feeling, sir?
I feel great. Everything is fine. Looking fresh. Feeling fresh. I'm good. I'm ready to rock. Let's do it.
So much to go. So much going on. I don't even know where to start. NFL action, fantasy football action,
Let's just start with this, because this is a cross-cultural situation. The Giants are in deep shit. We won last week. We got ran out of the fucking gym this week versus the Saints. Our guy, Alvin Kamara, stuffed it up our ass. Stuffed it up the Giants' ass. Of course, Alvin Kamara plays for the New Orleans Saints. Sean Payton, friend of the Iron Rapport Stereo podcast, they did a doozy on the Giants. Did you watch that game, Mr. Moody?
Yeah, I watched the second half of it. Yeah, I thought they were going to make a comeback, but it wasn't in the cards.
Yeah, Alvin Kamara scored the last touchdown and just ran the fuck into the locker room. Is a record-breaking NFL season. Chicago Bears quarterback Mitch Trubisky somehow, some fucking way. And Aaron from Chicago, first-tier Iron Rapport Stereo podcast fan and Rapapack member, A-Ron, double A-Ron, you know and I know and the whole world knows that Mitch fucking Trubisky has no business throwing for 6 touchdowns in 3 quarters. That motherfucker threw for 6 touchdowns in 3 quarters.
Damn. That's good.
Yeah, well, that's like good, that. But it just goes to show that the defense is... It's not that Mitch Trubisky and Baker fucking Mayfield and all these guys are that much better than we set them out to be. It just goes to show that the defenses, as we've documented over and over and over and discussed over and over and over, and our guy Warren Sapp broke down over and over and over.
Yeah.
They're at such a disadvantage. Yes, we want scoring, but 6 touchdowns in 3 quarters from Mitch Trubisky?
Oh, they turning this shit into Tecmo Bowl because they can't play defense because they're fucking watching everything. And they turn it football. It's not football anymore. You see? We're not watching football.
Yeah, it's getting out of it. And they want everybody to be Steph Curry. Let Steph Curry be Steph Curry.
Yeah. Yeah. I like the violence. Yo, these people know what they're signing up for. They've been playing football since they're 9, 10 years old. It's a violent game, man. And that's why it's exciting. And, yo, hopefully no CTE comes. But, yo, this is what they play. They make a lot of money. They know what they're signing up for. Come on, man.
Speaking of violence, Earl Thomas, all everything Seattle Seahawk. Who has been struggling with his contract with the Seattle Seahawks for the last year and a half. It feels like this started last year. He threatened to sit out. He wound up not sitting out. Earl Thomas, the great Earl Thomas, wound up getting hurt, which is like your worst nightmare when you're concerned about your contract. His contract only covers him through the end of this year. This is why he wanted to renew his contract. He outplayed and outperformed his contract. This is similar to what Le'Veon Bell has been complaining about. And the reason why Le'Veon Bell, in 4 weeks of the NFL season, has sat out. Earl Thomas broke his leg. They say it's not a career-ending break and that he'll be back. But, like, this is the shit that he was concerned about. Yo, if I get injured, what happens to me now? Up until game 4, week 4 of the NFL season, statistically, he was the best defensive player in the league. With all the bullshit that was going on and all the Seattle sucks. They're not what they used to be. Earl Thomas was still doing his thing, but he wound up breaking his leg. And Le'Veon Bell said, now I'll be the bad guy for everybody else, so on and so forth. So I don't know how this is going to end, Mr. Moody. Do you have any insight into what's going to happen with Le'Veon Bell?
This guy... broke his leg again. This is the second break. He broke this leg 2 years ago. So now you're not getting the contract you want. You took a risk playing. Le'Veon said, nah, I'm not going to do it. So you took that risk. Unfortunately, the leg is broken again. Now you put the owners in a position to say, well, we're not going to give you the contract based on you breaking your leg twice. So it's over for my man. Unfortunately,
It's not. What do you mean it's over?
As far as the contract, as him getting that big money, I don't think that's going to happen.
Yeah.
I don't think that's going to happen.
I agree. And also, they were actually in trade negotiation talks with a couple of teams, one of them being the Kansas City Chiefs. It's fucked up.
Yeah.
I feel bad for Earl Thomas. I feel bad for all these football players. That something has to give. There has to be some sort of give to the players because it's such a high-risk sport, and that's why the owners don't want to play them. Like Dez Bryant, he signed a 5-year contract. He played 3 of those 5 years. They cut his fucking ass. See,
is he still getting paid for the final 2, or it's no pay?
No, I mean, there might be some pay because there's probably some guaranteed money. But no, they released him. He's done. And now he hasn't signed with another team, which is crazy to me. But it is what it is. Yeah. It is what it is. The guy who we've talked about, we actually discussed him with Sapp the other day, Eric Reid, former All-Pro from the San Francisco 49ers. He was blackballed, in my opinion. These are my words. He was blackballed out of the NFL for the last year and a half or year and a quarter. He has signed. This is an All-Pro, a 26-year-old All-Pro. He was completely out of football last season. And up until last week, he was not signed with the team. He has signed with Cam Newton and the Carolina Panthers. I'm happy for this dude. Everything I know about him, he's a family dude. He's never made a lot of money in the NFL. He's got 2 kids, and he was pushed out of football. But the Carolina Panthers are like, fuck it. I mean, the name of the game is winning. So they stepped up to the plate. Riverboat Ron and the Carolina Panthers, shout out to you guys. I'm wishing Eric Reid a successful, healthy season. Hopefully he will kick ass and be the player that he can be, and he'll get all the money that he can get. And congratulations to him, to his family, and congratulations and kudos to fucking Riverboat Ron and the Panthers for saying, you know what, we're trying to win fucking football games. We're going to put the best players on the field.
Yeah, yeah. Good for them. Good for him. Play football and worry about football. That's all I got to say about that. Play football.
And the Patriots, people were saying they're done. They came back 1-2. They came back and beat the shit out of the 3-0 Miami Dolphins. So the Patriots aren't dead, and I suspect, I have nothing against the Dolphins, but they do this every fucking year. I suspect they will be going on a downhill fast slide, and the Patriots just opened them up real nice, almost shutting them out. I believe it was 38-7 or 36-7. You know this is the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. We don't fact check anything.
Yeah, the Dolphins are still trying to replace Dan Marino at quarterback, so they always start out kind of good, and they never make the fucking playoffs.
Yeah, Dan Marino, that's been the 80s. That shit's not happening. Dan Marino, his curly locks and all that fly shit and his blue eyes. Move forward. Move forward with your life. Dan Marino's done. Yeah. Motherfucker's 50-something years old. Let that man rest.
Yeah. They can't replace him. I mean, they've had so many quarterbacks. That's how good he has been, and that's how, you know, quarterbacking is hard. So they still haven't replaced that guy.
Yeah, he's still talking about fucking Dan, pretty boy Dan. I Am Rapaport Podcast. I think it's the 50th anniversary. Let me see. 50th anniversary? Would it be 50? 50 years ago. I think, or 45 years ago, and I think it was 45 years ago, I saw something, the Thrilla in Manila, the Ali Frazier fight, they fought 3 times, this was the 3rd fight, 15 rounds in the Philippines heat, you know, one of the best fights ever. If you've never sat down and watched that fight, you could YouTube it. It's a fucking war. It's a war. Ali basically just outlasted Joe Frazier in that fight. And there's been documentaries just about that fight from both sides, Frazier and Ali. And it's just, you know, fights now 12 rounds, as they should be, because that's one of the fights where the repercussions and the damage took place, you know, a few years later, and both those fighters were never the same out of the ring. after that fight. But the Thrilla Manila, if you've never seen that fight, YouTube it and take a look at it. Of course, the great Ali defeated the great smoking Joe Frazier in 15 brutal fucking rounds. It just brutal fucking rounds of boxing.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's boxing is, man, that's fight. It's a fight. That's what they call it. It's a fight. I like those fights. That's why they're so loved, because it's going at each other, whoever falls down. I love those type of fights.
Speaking of fights, Conor McGregor will be fighting this fucking Saturday in Vegas, UFC number, I don't know what, UFC number 370 or 944, I don't know what it is. Again, this is the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. We do not fact check. He'll be fighting that dude, Khabib. Obviously, the shit-talking that has went down with Conor McGregor is well-documented on this here I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. Matter of fact, just for shits and giggles, Miles, Jordan, let's get those bagpipes. So this Saturday night, Conor McGregor will be fighting Khabib. Khabib is a fucking beast. He's from somewhere in the Ukraine or Russia or Turkey. No disrespect. No disrespect. I'm not fact-checking, but I expect this to be a brutal fight. Homeboy used to wrestle bears when he was young. Khabib, I think he's Russian or German, something. I don't know what he is. Do you know what he is, Moody?
Nah, I don't watch that shit, but I mean, yo, it's going to be a good fight.
Yeah. Khabib is a rough and tumble dude. Obviously, Conor McGregor is one of the best UFC fighters in his division, One of the best fighters of all time. The last time he was in the ring, it was for a boxing match where Floyd Mayweather beat the shit out of him. And fortunately, the referee stopped the fight before he wound up on the floor of the MGM Grand, where I was sitting four rows back, very close to the action. I can't wait for this. Our guy, Derek Lewis, who had a really fucked up fight the last time he was out, the Beast, the UFC Beast, friend of the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast, is also fighting. I cannot wait for this shit. Because Conor McGregor, man, you could say what you want about him. You could say what you want to say about UFC. He's one of the great shit talkers in all of sports history. And the hype is real. But these guys are going to be throwing down this Saturday night at UFC. I don't know if it's 863. I don't know what the fuck it is. But I'm going to be watching. Yeah. And I'm going to be watching our guy, Derek Lewis.
Yeah, I like Conor McGregor. This is his element. UFC, I don't doubt that he's going to win. This is how this is where he's at his best in that style of fighting. So I expect him to kick ass. I Am Rapaport
Podcast. So obviously, we released a emergency podcast very early Sunday morning, hours after Kanye West's Saturday Night Live debacle. It's a fucking debacle. And we're going to get into more Kanye West because once he gets going, it's like a fucking avalanche. But before we talk about Kanye West, I wanted to discuss and suggest and remind the fans and the people of five hip-hop producers that are more interesting, just as prolific, and not off their fucking rocker. That Kanye West. These are five hip-hop producers that I wanted to just celebrate and acknowledge as being more interesting to listen to, not self-indulgent, not narcissistic, and not totally out of their fucking tree. And G, you could feel free to add to a few more of these, but I thought these five out, and I want to throw them at you one by one. Number one, a guy who never talks. It really is only and all about the music. His body of work is so dense, so large, and so eclectic. The great Mad Lib, who you actually hipped me 2 years ago for his classic Quasimodo record.
Yeah.
If you've never listened to Mad Lib, look him up. The motherfucker's done so much. So many different styles, boom, bap, jazz, soul, funk. Like, he covers the whole fucking thing, way out there, jazz. He scored my documentary on A Tribe Called Quest, Beats, Rhymes, and Life, The Travels of A Tribe Called Quest. Mad Lib is one of the best to ever do it. You can barely get a fucking word out of this guy in real life. He's only about that music, about digging in those crates and creating beats.
I mean, like you said, he's a master craftsman. He's really immersed in the craft of beat making and switching samples and doing stuff. He doesn't talk because he's too busy doing the beats, but he's not a star.
Another person more prolific, and I think if you did on record sales, if that's what you want to argue, he's been doing it for decades now. He has the best record, the best song on the new Lil Wayne Carta 5 or Magna Carta 5. I can't listen to an entire Lil Wayne record. I've never been able to listen to an entire Lil Wayne record. I know that he's dope, and there's a lot of Lil Wayne songs that I like, but there's not one Lil Wayne record that I would listen to all the way through and say everything on that record is dope. But I did listen to the Carta 5 record that he put out the other day. Hardcore Lil Wayne fans, including Mr. Morris, the creative executive of all memes of the Iron Rapport Stereo podcast. The guy goes viral every single week now. He's the Minister of Defense also, and a hard body karate Rapid Pack member. I went off of his review. He said that the Lil Wayne record was weak, so I say that the Lil Wayne record is weak. I can't judge it, again, because I don't listen to him like that, but Swiss Beats did make the best song on the new Lil Wayne record. Swiss Beats has made so many hits for so many years for so many different artists, from Jay-Z to DMX to this banger called Uproar on this Lil Wayne record. Swiss Beats is coming in as one of the other producers who's more interesting and just as prolific than Kanye West to listen to. I don't need to listen to fucking Kanye West anymore. Number three, DJ Muggs of Cypress Hill, dusty, eclectic, way out there, boom bap. The samples are incredible. They're always dirty. They're always totally original. Been doing it for years, all Cypress. He produced the mega fucking banger Jump Around from House of Pain, their one and only true blue cross-cultural hit. DJ Muggs, they just dropped Elephants on Acid, the Cypress Hill banger. I love that fucking record. My favorite song on that record, if you just want to check it out, is called Band of Gypsies. Classic Cypress Hill. They're going back and forth, and the samples are just fucking dumb. They're dumb. DJ Muggs is a motherfucker, and he's another guy. You never hear from him. You never hear him talk. You never see him, like, talking. You just, like, it's just the music. He's dedicated to the music. He's not out there trying to make political statements. The fourth producer who's more interesting and more prolific than fucking Kanye West, friend of the I Am Rapport Stereo podcast, DJ Premier. Moody, I'll let you pontificate on DJ Premier for a little bit, please.
Oh, DJ Premier is one of the best as far as sampling, as far as piecing the samples together, as far as chopping everything. It's on another level. His ear, in order to really sample and really disguise what you're doing, you have to have an ear. And he has one of the best ears I've heard, because I've heard a lot of the original records that he has used. And it's incredible when you hear it and you go, oh, shit, he took this from here and this and that. DJ Premier, you don't have to, that name is self-explanatory. So, yo, he's one of the best. He's one of my favorites.
And if you've never heard Premier on the I Am Rapport Stereo podcast, it's a hashtag Goosebumps podcast. There's so many stories, so many gems, and so many just great tidbits. DJ Premier on the I Am Rapport Stereo podcast. And finally, fifth most prolific producer that you could listen to instead of listening to fucking Kanye West. They call him the Abstract. Q-Tip from A Tribe Called Quest needs no introduction. The motherfucker's sound, he changed the game. He made such dope hip-hop songs that a lot of them turned into cross-cultural pop music. Check the Rhyme is like a fucking pop song. It's so good. It's so sing-song. It's so simple. But the sampling, the jazz, he's one of the first people to bring in the jazz. such knowledge. I talked to Tip the other day, actually, and he's teaching a class at NYU, which is dope. I said, I want to come sit in on the class because that motherfucker is like a Google. He's like an encyclopedia of all things music. He gets inside the instruments, who played them, how they played them, how it was recorded, but he talks about it in such basic ways. I mean, listen, Tribe, Tip, all the shit that he did outside of Tribe Called Quest, Q-Tip, the abstract poetic, one of the great producers of all time, Kanye West, bows down to Q-Tip, bows down to Swiss Beats, bows down to Pharrell. So fuck this nut job. Just listen to the guys that he looks up to. Listen to the guys that he learned the craft from. That's my point on this. Gee, Kanye West has made a fucking asshole out of himself, made a spectacle out of himself once again. One of the things that I admire and respect about you, Mr. Moody, is that you don't get involved. You've never paid that much attention to this fucking guy. Are you aware of the antics that have went down this weekend with Kanye West?
I saw pieces of it online, and yeah, I saw it. Yeah, it was wild. But one thing I did like. But go ahead. I'll let you finish.
Go ahead. I've been talking enough.
I like, of course, the performance was sucked, but I like how he kind of flipped. When people say, "Oh, they're bullying me." So he flipped it and turned it around and used the same thing. Let's say, oh, they bullied me. I choose to wear this hat, and they told me that I can't wear the hat. But these are the same folks that say, yo, we don't want to be bullied and this and that. So he flipped that around and said, look, they're doing the same shit. Why can't I wear this fucking hat? If I like this guy, so what? Why do I have to be lambasted and why am I lynched, so to speak, just because I say I like this guy or whoever he likes? This is the point that I got from that. And I'm like, that's true. How are you gonna tell this motherfucker he can't support who he support? Who the fuck are you to say that?
Well, I think that all sounds good in writing. But here's what I think about specifically about what you just brought up. Miles, play that clip of him saying they bullied me.
Try love. You see, they laughing at me. You heard them, they scream at me. They bully me. They bullied me backstage. They said, don't go out there with that hat on. They bullied me backstage. They bullied me.
So it's kind of hard to hear because this was after Saturday Night Live. This was all covered in the Emergency Iron Rapaport Stereo podcast, which was up. It's still up. Premium subscribers, the best of the best Iron Rapaport Stereo podcast fans. Here's what I have to say about that, Mr. Moody, and I want to throw this at you. He said they bullied me backstage. Who?
For wearing a hat.
Whoa. Who bullied him? Who?
I guess the producers or whatever. No, don't wear the hat.
Who's the they? He's such a tough guy. Let me finish.
He's such a
tough guy. He's such a big speaker. He's so outspoken. Who bullied him? Who bullied him? Remember last time he was on there? We did a whole thing about him talking shit to Lauren Michaels, and we suggested what Lauren Michaels would say. Tell him to shut the fuck up. This is what I think, Moody, about that specifically, because I follow this closer than you do. I don't think anybody fucking bullied him. I think he's making this shit up. This guy is a chronic fucking liar. This guy's full of shit. He said that same night that he said they bullied me at Saturday Night Live that he was releasing a brand new album.
Yeah.
Saturday came and went. Yeah. The motherfucker didn't drop an album. A couple of weeks ago, he tweeted out, Watch the Throne 2, to do part 2 of the Watch the Throne with him and Jay-Z. I don't think Jay-Z has spoken to this guy. I think this guy's a fucking liar. So when he says they bullied me, who bullied you? Come on, tough guy. You're out there naming names. You got your fucking cape on. You got your super paros. Who bullied you? Who? Did Michael Che bully you? Did Lauren Michaels bully you? Who bullied you? The cast of Saturday Night Live? The host, Adam Driver? No one fucking bullied you. This guy's making this shit up.
But if he, let's say he made it up, then he's trying to make the point that, yo, you say all this bullying shit, and now I put this fucking hat on, and everybody's telling me, what the fuck are you doing? But he's saying, I think he's saying, listen, I can support, I can like whoever I want to like.
Like fuck whoever you want to like. And why?
That's his point. Like, yo, leave me alone.
Well, then you know what? Your man needs to get a better grasp of how to articulate himself and get his point across. Because my point is this. You're making up shit, Duke. And my other point is this. Where's your fucking whiz at? Where's your wife at? Where's Kendall, Chloe, Kylie, and all them at? Now one of them has stand up and said anything in support of this motherfucker. Where's your family at, Duke? Where's your whiz at?
I think they were there. I think she was there. But yo, that dude, yo, he's out there, no doubt. But as far as, yo, you could support whoever you want to support, rap. I could support whoever I want to support. But the thing is, I can't tell you, if you put a red hat on, I don't give a fuck. I don't care. That's who you get down with. So what? The point is, yo, if this guy likes Trump or whatever, so what?
Why
is it the end of the world when this guy says, yo, I'm rocking with homeboy? Why does it trigger people so much?
Oh, you're using the word trigger?
Answer the question. Why?
Because people don't like this motherfucker.
So what? That's you. That's them. But this is him. He has a right to support and like whoever he wants.
Yeah,
like
you should respect that. And people have a right to say they don't agree. People have a right to say that he's full of shit. People have a right to say, when you're talking about abolishing the 13th Amendment and you're on a private jet and your Yeezys are made in China and the hat that you're so proud of is made in China and you're on a private jet, people have a right to call him on his bullshit. It's him. He brings all that attention on himself because he's an obnoxious bullshitter who's like, I mean, listen, everybody likes attention, but goddamn, motherfucker. I mean, good Lord. And then you get up on the Saturday Night Live stage, the same stage that Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five perform on, the same stage that Stevie Wonder and every single other person in music in the last 45 years has get up there. You get up there and give for a half-ass effort. It wasn't that the songs were whack. It was that they were just like, it was like the effort wasn't there. Like you have no respect for Saturday Night Live. You have no respect for the forum. You have no respect for the crew that's up there working on. You have no respect for the fans. It's that. This motherfucker's, and you're a liar. Nobody bullied you, Duke. Nobody, who bullied you?
I believe that no one bullied him. But he's making the point like, yo, everybody hates me because I said this and this and that. I put this hat on, they fucking saying it, telling me don't wear the fuck. He's making that point. He's throwing it back on them. Yo, they're bullying me. These people are bullying me.
Yeah, so, well, he's bullying everybody. I agree. Hey, he's a 41-year-old guy talking about he getting bullied. What kind of pussy shit is that? Oh, they're bullying me. They're bullying me. Motherfucker, you and I, this ain't dodgeball. This ain't a game of dodgeball in the fourth grade.
He's not being bullied. That was some bullshit, but he's just trying to make a point. I understood it, but, yo, this dude is out there. I don't really pay too much attention to this cat, but I just say, yo, let that man live, man. He can rock with whoever he want to rock with. It shouldn't get under people's skin so crazy, so hard. Like, they hate this dude. It's crazy, man.
And Donald Trump and Dick Stain Donald Trump and Dick Stain Donald Trump Jr., they praised Kanye for what he did on Saturday Night Live. Well, it was actually after Saturday Night Live. And I ask you this, Dick Stain Donald Trump and Dick Stain Jr., can you recite, since you're such big fans of Kanye West, can you recite one line from one of his songs? Since you're such big fans and you appreciate him so much, do you know anything about his music, or do you just like having a guy like that?
Well, Donald Trump can say too. Raekwon and Outkast made a song called Black Trump, and Raekwon specifically said, "Guess who's the Black Trump?" So, yo, this shit is crazy. Kanye is wild. People shouldn't pay so much attention to an entertainer. It's crazy.
Before I get to what I'm going to do to Candace Owens, because I'm about to give her that Willie Hutch, because I can't stand this little mousy ass.
Oh,
big mouth.
Why?
Oh, I'll get to it when I when
okay,
I get to
I
it.
Okay, I
want to
hear this. I got to hear this.
I'm going to give her that Willie Hutch. The Kanye West Cuckoo's Nest tour is continuing. He went to TMZ again, and I wanted to play this little portion of this sit-down that he had with Harvey Levin. Kanye West sat down with Harvey Levin, who runs TMZ. He's also a big supporter of Donald Trump. But so check this out, Moody. We're going to give this a little play-by-play. Hold on. All right, so here's Kanye West with Harvey Levin. Hold on, here it goes.
Okay. So you said the album was coming out on Saturday. It didn't come out. What happened?
Where the fucking album at, okay. Duke? Where's the fucking album out? Harvey, just add you, where's the fucking album out? You knew that was going to be the first question he asked you. You told your fans that the album was coming out. Where the fucking record at? Harvey wants to know. Harvey's a fan.
So you said the album was coming out on Saturday. It didn't come out. What happened?
Where the fucking album at, Duke? Where's the fucking album out? Harvey, just add you, where's the fucking album out? You knew that was going to be the first question he asked you. You told your fans that the album was coming out. Where the fucking record at? Harvey wants to know. Harvey's a fan.
I didn't finish it. A person from my management staff, from our management staff.
Name names. See, I think he's lying again here, G. He said, a person from my management staff. Why don't you name names? My man Craig, my man Doug, my man Frank said. You're making up shit.
You know, I've started incorporating, like, sounds that you've never heard before and pushing and having, like, you know, concepts that people don't, you know, talk about.
See, this is what I'm saying, G. Sounds that you never heard before. Concepts that people don't talk about. This is what I'm talking about. This is that narcissistic bullshit. You're not Van Gogh, Duke. You're not Pablo Picasso. You're not the five producers that I just named. You're not Q-Tip. You're not DJ motherfucking Muggs. You're not Swiss Beats. Where's the fucking record at?
We have concepts talking about, you know, body shaming and...
You making a song about body shaming? You just... Hey, yo, you know why else this guy's a sick fuck? He's 41 years old. Little Pump, who he just put out a song with, is 18.
Oh, where he rocking like that?
You 41. If that was my son, I would be like, yo, you're not having my son on this record saying all this crazy shit. You're not having.
Bro, they love.
Yeah. But if you had an 18-year-old son, would you want him hanging out with a 41-year-old who's in questionable mental health? Fuck is you talking about, Duke?
They love that guy, man. Those 18, he's a big time influence on those guys. They love this guy, man.
I know. And if I was Lil Pump, I would get the fuck away from Kanye West because he's gonna ruin your career.
You know, women being looked down upon for how many people that they slept with, and you know, it's just a full Yay album, and those five albums that I dropped earlier were like superhero rehabilitation.
Duke. Where the fucking record?
Well,
at,
yeah,
Duke?
Yeah. Why are you talking about it? It's the record, yo. The record is coming out here. It's funky. It's gonna be this, man. Kill all that bullshit, man. See, that's the problem that I have, yo. It's about music. These motherfuckers put you on some kind of pedestal where you think you Dr. Ruth or something. We don't give a fuck about all that. What is the drums pounding? The sample's good. You got DJs, the scratching. How's that? Where the chorus? That's what it's about. He can't see. They put this motherfucker up on some pedestal, and this is how he feels. That's the problem. That shit is whack.
Where the record at, Duke? We don't want to hear about the speech about what it's gonna be. You said the shit was coming out on Saturday. It's fucking Tuesday. Where the fucking record at?
You know, and now the alien Ye is like fully back in mode, off of medication.
He talking about alien Ye and all this bullshit.
What the fuck, man?
you know, working out, breathing as much fresh air as possible, thinking, doing, being himself, you know. And when I say being myself, that doesn't mean I'm being Donald Trump. It means I'm being me and I'm punk.
Oh, now you punk rock. Now you bad brains shit.
Oh, why a motherfucker gotta announce that he's being himself? Just be yourself. Do what you do. That's how you know it's fake. Oh, I'm punk. Why don't you just do it? It's fake shit, man. I am Rapaport Podcast.
Miles, Jordan, I told you I was going to do this. This little Candace Owens. Matter of fact, cue that Willie Hutch. No, you hear that, Willie? No. Candace Owens, little Republican cheerleader, the African-American Republican cheerleader. She said that Kanye West, these are her words, baby, don't do it, quote unquote, he's one of the bravest men in America for saying what he's saying. Says who, lady? Who the fuck are you? Who gives a fuck what you think? He's one of the bravest men in America. You got firefighters, you got policemen, you got people doing all kind of real shit, and this guy's one of the bravest men in America? Says who? Baby, don't do it. Says who? What do you do, Candace Owens? You make money being a ride or die Republican chick. And that makes you dumb smart. Not like dumb smart, like, oh, yo, she's dumb smart. That makes you dumb smart. I don't give a fuck how many books you read and the quotes and the history of politics and the history of this and all that shit. The fact that you ride or die for anything, any person, any political party, any gang, anybody in your family, 500% that you ride or die despite the way they act or behave, makes you dumb. And you read a couple of books, you know a couple of quotes, so you're dumb smart. You hang out with these motherfucking Republicans unbiasedly. You'll say anything. Anything. You support these motherfuckers no matter what they do. You're not smart. The motherfucking crackers at the Kavanaugh hearing. You think they respect your ass? You think they wouldn't disrespect you in private? You don't think they would make passes at you in private? They're just happy to have a young, attractive black lady tooting their fucking horns. That's it. That's it. That's the only fucking reason why you're on Fox News is because you look different than the rest of the crackers. You ain't all that. And you a groupie for Kanye West. Is that's all you are? You're a fucking groupie. Kanye West co-signed you. And all of a sudden, people know your name. You're just a little motherfucking groupie. You know about Republicans. You know about Democrats. But do you know about this motherfucking Willie Hutch? Cut the music, dude.
Hey, I ain't got shit to say. I don't agree with none of that bullshit you said, but I ain't got shit to say. I like Candace Owens, and she has a lot of fresh takes on shit, and a lot of her shit is right. And like I'll say to you, you can't tell her what to fucking think. And whoever else says that, she is a breath of fresh air, and she's unusual. And I know motherfuckers look at her like, oh, she doesn't fit. Her takes aren't the usual black person takes. So it's unusual. But most of that shit she kicks is right, and it's based in history and facts. So the Willie Hutch is fine, but yo, I fuck with Candace Owens because I like that thinking.
Yeah, well, what's also based in history and facts is that if she was alone with any one of them old motherfuckers, they would be disrespectful to her ass. They'd be saying all kind of wild shit to her ass. That's based in history and facts also.
Oh, just them? Everybody. I mean, the other side would say the same shit.
I'm just like, she's ride or die blindly. She's blindly ride or die for all things Republican. If you blind, if you're blindly ride or die for anything, a gang, anything, you're a fucking idiot. If you ride, the reason why I can't respect her is because she sees nothing wrong with anything that has to do with the Republican Party. Fuck her. That's why she got that motherfucking Dusty Willie Hutch. I am Rapaport Podcast. The NBA season is right around the corner. The Lakers made their debut in preseason the other night. I saw it. Did you see LeBron out there with the gold and purple on?
Yeah, I saw some clips of that. I expect nothing less from LeBron doing his thing. I know what time it is.
He's out of Cleveland. Cleveland is only making noise for what we talked about last week with guys like Tristan Thompson talking dumb shit. And then J.R. Smith. J.R. fucking Smith, the guy that ruined King James's chance to even make the finals competitive. We all know what happened. LeBron had 50 or 51 points, played one of his best games of his entire career. J.R. Smith, instead of putting the layup back up, you dribbled the ball out, you fucked it away, and we haven't heard from you since, until you show up in preseason with a foot-long Supreme tattoo on the back of your leg. Supreme is the brand, which, by the way, started out as a skateboard brand in like 1994, 95. This fucking guy got a foot-long tattoo of Supreme on the back of his leg. The NBA, because it's a brand, said every time you go out on the court and you don't cover that shit up, we're going to fine your fucking ass. I don't know why this guy wants to bring attention to himself. In my opinion, the only fucking tattoo that you should have on the back of your leg is LeBron James stats from game one. Why don't you tattoo that up there? Why don't you tattoo the amount of timeouts a team has? Why don't you tattoo the score of the game? You get branded from a brand. Now let's see if this brand, Supreme, that you love so much, that you didn't get a little tattoo. The motherfucker got a foot long tattoo, thick black ink on the back of his leg. Let's see if this brand that you adore so much and you love so much, why don't you go out there and not cover it up and see if Supreme loves you that much? Let's see if Supreme will cover their fines.
Yeah. Are they sponsoring him? Is that why they did he do that? Because they're being sponsored by Supreme?
Gerald, let me tell you something. Throughout my 20-something years, I've had many sponsorships. This I Am Rapaport Stereo podcast has had many sponsorships. But you don't see me with a fucking DraftKings tattoo on my fucking forehead. You don't see, I mean, does he just love Supreme that much? Well, why don't you get like Listerine tattooed across your upper lip because that's your favorite mouthwash? Why don't you get like Dove because that's the soap you use? It doesn't matter if they're sponsoring him or not. This isn't some Halloween tattoo that you wipe off. This motherfucker got a tattoo on the back of his leg. And I say, JR, fuck that. You rocked for Supreme. You love them so much. See if they will pay the fines that you're now going to have to pay if you don't cover that dumb shit up.
I was saying that because if they are like sponsoring him, endorsing him like Nike, then I could, you doing that, you're getting paid or whatever. But if it's no endorsement and he's just doing that, that man is too old to be putting that shit on his body and not getting any payment. That's crazy. That's really immature. That's childish shit. That's what kids do.
So It is the ultimate sucker shit.
I hope that the guy's getting paid. Then I wouldn't diss him. But if that's because I like Supreme and I'm just going to rock it, man, yo, you need to go to a psychiatrist, yo.
Fuck. Yo, I don't know how much the fine is if he doesn't cover it up, like a leg sleeve or something like that. But let's just say it's $10,000 a game. We're talking about $820,000. Supreme, you guys are a big dick company. Everybody loves it. Cover JR's price.
Supreme is like, we didn't ask this motherfucker to do that.
Yeah, we don't even know this fucking guy. We don't even give him free shit.
We ain't got shit to do with that. We ain't got shit to do with that.
And my guy, Steven Jackson, you know, he was arguing that it was fucked up that the NBA does it. I'm not saying whether the NBA should do this or not. I'm saying, J.R. Smith, what the fuck is wrong with you? Whether or not the NBA has a right to do that or doesn't have a right to do that, I don't care about that. The fact that you branded yourself with a brand is insane. We're not talking about your favorite rapper. We're not talking about children's names. We're not talking about parents' names. We're not talking about the street you're from. You put a fucking t-shirt company on your back of your leg, and it's not discreet. Not like a little thing like, yo, I rock with Supreme, like a little thing. This shit is like one of the biggest tattoos I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, yeah. Man, Supreme must be so happy. Imagine the general manager in the company. Imagine you'd be like, oh, shit, look at this guy. we didn't even call this motherfucker. Man.
I mean, it's not like fucking Kevin Durant or Russell Westbrook or Kyrie Irving. You got a guy who's known for not living up to his expectations. We got a guy who's never lived up to his full talent potential. We got a guy that, like, the thing that he'll be most known for is fucking up game one of the 2018 NBA Finals. These are the things he's most known for. So I know they're probably like, what the fuck, man?
But also, he is an NBA champion. You have to say that when he retires. Like, NBA champ, like Super Bowl champ, Warren Sapp, NBA champ, J.R. Smith. Same shit.
Hey, he contributed to the Cavaliers winning an NBA championship, and he was one of the main contributors to the Cleveland Cavaliers getting swept out of the next season's NBA championship. So that's what you get with J.R. Smith. All right, here we go. Miles Jordan. Please cue up the sick fuck of the week music.
This award is earned, not given. It's called the sick fuck of the week. This guy's really sick. Lock him up.
How could you do it?
Don't let him out.
Damn. Who fucked the dog?
You what?
Who fucked the dog?
Why would he fuck the dog? Why would you fuck your girlfriend's dog?
What sick fuck?
The sick fuck of the week. It's earned.
Earned.
Not given.
You did
what?
No.
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 No! This is an award that is earned, not given. This is an award that is earned, not given. It goes to a person with a certain je ne sais quoi. This one I'm going to have to post online because this is like justice. The first guy, do yourself a favor. Do yourself a favor and look up Joshua Glenn Box. Joshua Glenn Box, who is a convicted sex offender, and it looks like a pit bull or some sort of hyena or a tiger bit Money's whole shit off. Money doesn't have a nose. Money doesn't have any lips, literally. Like, he's deformed. Maybe this happened in prison. I would love to find out how Money's grill got fucked up, but he doesn't have a nose. He doesn't have any lips. He's a convicted sex offender. And by everything that I've been able to look up about Joshua Glenn Box, this happened after he was convicted as a sex offender. But do yourself a favor and look this guy up because he looks like a true blue sick fuck of the week. But Joshua Glenn Box, convicted sex offender, was arrested again. Again.
For what?
For having more child pornography. Lock him up for good. Let him bite his fucking nose, like his ears off. He has no nose to bite off. You have to look this guy up. He looks like shit. I mean, he looks crazy. He looks like something out of a horror movie.
Yeah, yo. Put this guy in front of a firing squad. All that, when you talk about kids, when I hear that shit, yo, there's no rehabilitation. Like, oh, I don't do that shit no more. Nah, we're going to ensure that you don't do it no more. Stand his ass up and cock these rifles. Fuck that dude, man.
This woman, again, the essence of a sick fuck. The woman's from Virginia. Her name is Crystal Mostek. She looks like a sick fuck. She's got the green hair. She's got the multiple tattoos that make no sense all over her face. She's got the piercings. She looks whacked out of her tree. She was arrested in Virginia a couple of days ago. She threatened to blow up the 7-Eleven convenience store. This happened in Virginia Beach. Shout out to Allen Iverson and all them. Alonzo Mourning from Virginia Beach. Shout out to Pharrell, Rex and Effect and all that. Teddy Riley was down there doing his thing. This woman has every single quality that makes her a true blue sick fuck of the week. You can't go into 7-Eleven talking greasy, talking crazy, talking about you're going to blow shit up. We arrest you. We arrest you. And you know what? When you look the way you look, I know you're not supposed to judge a book by its cover, but you will get more attention than the normal person if you look like this sick fuck. In Russia, a woman is on the trains and on the buses, the public transportation in Russia. A 25-year-old woman, she calls it man-spreading. You know how men, a lot of times we sit with our legs open to let the cock and balls hang low?
Yeah, they got to get air.
This is referred to by some people as man-spreading. I've never heard this term. These are some of these newfound white guilt hipster terms. This woman is walking up to men on the bus and on the train in Russia. People that are quote-unquote man-spreading, sitting with their legs open, with clothes on, fully clothed, walking up to them and pouring bleach all over them, pouring bleach on their crotches when they are not paying attention. Lock this animal up. Everybody's an activist. Man. Everybody's a fucking activist. Now we lock you up.
Yeah, and the male species is at war. They're at war with the male species, man spreading. I guess that's toxic masculinity. Anything a man does is toxic. Get the fuck out of here. I wish you would pour some bleach on me sitting on the train. I'll tear your ass up in the tunnel.
These aren't sick. These are actually sick fucks, but they're not humans. There are zombie-like raccoons all over the Bronx. You need to pay attention to this. Pelham Parkway in Pelham Bay Park in the Bronx, it has been infected by what they are referring to as zombie raccoons. These critters are believed to have canine distemper virus, a fatal illness that can affect humans, but can be also spread to dogs. Any sick raccoons that have been found are humanely euthanized. I know you like to hang out in the parks, Moody. You got a daughter. Your daughter's got friends. There are zombie raccoons all over the Bronx. Be careful. Be careful with your animals. Be careful with your cats and dogs. Because if they come across, they don't even need to be bit by these zombie raccoons. If they come across, if they rub up, and they even rub up on some of the areas that the zombie raccoons have been in, they can affect your cat or dog. Be careful, Moody. Be very careful.
But, yes, but in this climate today, you can't do anything to animals, right? So it'll be a problem if I cut one of these motherfuckers' head off, right? So that's the thing now. Everybody's an animal guy. Let a motherfucker rub up on me or my daughter. I'm butterflying that motherfucker straight up and down. I'll tell you straight up.
Oh, well, just wear some gloves when you do it. This was sent to me by a friend of the Iron Rapport Stereo Podcast who just got me my grill. My man Paul Wall just sent me my first gold grill. We were hanging out with him in Houston. He sent me the Hero Grills. I remember in 1985, I asked my mom if she would get me a gold tooth. I believe you might have been at that meal when I asked my mom that. She said, fuck no. I begged and pleaded. I said, will you get it for me as a birthday gift? Fuck no. Christmas gift. She said, fuck no. I'm not getting you one. You can't spend your own money on it. And thank God she didn't let me do it. Yeah. But at 48, my guy Paul Wall just sent me a full fucking grill. These are Hero Grills he gave us. He did the fitting when we were at the Houston show. He sent us this sick fuck. A Florida man the other day lined up from across the street, took a knee with a shotgun, and shot a puppy in broad daylight.
Oh, man.
Johansson De La Ross of Florida, 19 years old, will face felony charges of animal cruelty. He shot an eight-month-year-old puppy that was doing nothing, that was harmless, that didn't bite anybody, with his rifle from across the street. They caught this sick fuck, and he's been arrested. Good, you sick fuck, you.
Yeah. Yeah. Somewhere down the line, you're going to pay for that. When you do heinous shit like that, you think, oh, it's over. Yo, somewhere down the line, that's going to be brought back up to you. Whether you're dead or not, I'm telling you, we do shit like that, it ain't over.
In New Hampshire, a New Hampshire man was arrested and fined because he kicked a seagull. He was at the beach eating. The seagull took a bite out of his cheeseburger, and this sick fuck kicked the seagull. Arrested, only fined $124, which in my opinion isn't enough. They should have gave this guy at least a weekend in the fucking cooler, if you ask me. Moody, would you kick a seagull that took a bite of your cheeseburger?
No, I would give the cheeseburger to the animal. Feed the animals. Feed them. I love them. I don't harm them. I wouldn't do anything. Here, have the whole shit, man.
Finally, this is a sick fucking mother in Missouri. Her son didn't make the varsity soccer team. Obviously, he just wasn't good enough. Your son ain't shit. But instead of instead of telling her son to try to find something else to do, you ain't Pele Duke. You're just not that dude. The mother is now suing the high school for discrimination after her son didn't make the varsity soccer team and was kicked off the junior varsity soccer team. Sweetheart.
Discrimination?
I didn't even go into the rules or the details of it. All I know is that, listen, Ma, your son, he's not all that. He's not getting to the league. He's just not that fucking good. If he was that good, they would have figured out a way to get him on the fucking team.
He ain't shit. He's not good at soccer. Maybe he could try again the next year. It's simple. Like, yo, money told you ain't that nice. So what you do? You work out all summer and you come back next year. That's how you build character, a participation trophy. Oh, get the fuck out of here, man. Come back next year and be better. That's how you build human beings. You're suing because of discrimination. Nah, he ain't shit.
Your son ain't shit, and you mad about it. Well, why are you mad at us? Why you want to? You think the court is going to take kindly to this shit? Yo, your son, he not good at kicking the fucking ball. He not good at juggling and passing and all that. Dismiss this fucking case, man. Money not getting on the team. You can't sue him onto the team. Imagine how he feels. Now he got to go to school, and all his friends that are actually good at soccer, they're going to look at him. You're just bringing more attention to your son who obviously ain't shit.
Word. Yo, a real parent would say, yo, you're not good enough now. But maybe next year, if you work harder and you work, you'll make the team. That's parenting. This other shit is some weak sucker shit. You're supposed to be off the team because you're not good enough. That's like you, Rap. You acting and shit. You can't read a line. And you sue the motherfucking movie company.
You can't, like, yo, learn to read, dumbass.
Word.
Alright, see, I am Rapaport Stereo Podcast, Boombastic Podcasting, G Moody, last name rhymes with duty. My name is the Gringo Mandingo. You have any closing statements, Moody?
Yes, one last thing. A cheating married woman called an Uber to go to the telly with her side piece, and when the Uber came, it was her husband.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I finished with that.
Miles Jordan, take us out of here with something funky. Tell a friend to tell a friend about the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast. If you haven't subscribed, rated us, subscribe, rate us. It's the I Am Rapaport Stereo Podcast, the best in the business. Hard-hitting, smash-mouth podcasting from the mouths, from the brains, from the minds of the Disco 2. I'm out.
Word up. Peace.